Thank you very much for the invitation to this very nice conference in this beautiful place, and I also would like to dedicate this talk to Laure. So I will start with the introduction of the Vlasov-Poisson equation and the 2D Euler equation, and I will try to see the links between both and then to explain the aim of the talk. So we have two different equations. It doesn't work. Sorry. Let me just try. Yes. So on the left, you have the two-dimensional Vlasov-Poisson equation, where F is the density of particles, of electric particles, let's say a plasma. And it evolves according to this equation. It is defined in the phase space, x and v, denote the variables in the space and the velocity. And rho is defined to be the integral of the average over the velocity space of the density. It's the macroscopic density. And E is the electric field, and it's defined to be this convolution kernel with a macroscopic density rho, which means that it is a gradient of the Laplacian minus one of rho, in fact. And on the other hand, we have the 2D Euler equation incompressible, dt omega plus u gradient omega equals to zero, and the divergence free condition on u, where omega is the vorticity and u the velocity. And we can recover the velocity in terms of the vorticity by this convolution here. So you see there is not much difference between both convolutions here. Okay? So the Vlasov-Poisson is the evolution for a microscopic density and the Euler equation for a macroscopic density. And the aim of the talk is to study the gyrokinetic limit for the Vlasov-Poisson system, which means that we consider a density of particles, of a plasma, which is subjected to a very strong magnetic field, which is orthogonal to the plane of the particles. And as it was said before, there is no unique gyrokinetic model, but here we will consider a scaling corresponding to the asymptotics of this equation. So we put a parameter epsilon here and here, and we represent the magnetic field by this V perp over epsilon squared, and we study the limit as epsilon goes to zero of this equation. So it is a rescaling of the previous equation in this regime. But you can also study different regimes corresponding to other gyrokinetic limits. And we will consider initial data for which satisfies some suitable and physical, more or less physical bounds. So I will present my result. So we consider first some assumptions on the initial data. As I said, they are uniformly bounded. They belong to L1. And they are compactly supported so that for each epsilon fixed, there is a unique global solution corresponding to the previous equation. It's a result by Okabe and Ukai from the 70s. And we also have uniform bounds on physical quantities. So we assume that the L1 norm of the probability density, which is in fact the mass of the density, is uniformly bounded. We also have a bound on the moment with respect to x and a bound on the energy. And the energy in the 2D case is defined to be the kinetic part here, V squared F, and the potential part with a logarithm. Okay. And in fact, it's known that these quantities are conserved by the flow of the Vlasov-Poisson equation, and therefore, if you assume uniform bounds initially, then you get uniform bounds for all time with respect to epsilon. And we also have we will also need an additional boundedness assumption on the L infinity norm of F epsilon zero, which means that it can blow up when epsilon goes to zero, but not too fast. So you need this bound. It's a technical assumption, in fact. But with this kind of initial data, you allow for initial data that converge to what is called monokinetic initial data. Monokinetic means that the velocity is concentrated. Sorry. You allow for initial densities for which the velocity is concentrated, is a Dirac mass on some u0 of x. Okay. So it suffices to consider this kind of initial data for a small parameter, delta epsilon, converging to zero not too fast. And this is my first result. So we assume that you start with initial data, satisfying the previous assumptions, and you consider the global unique solution. And then you can prove that there exists a subsequence such that the macroscopic density, rho epsilon n, converges in some weak sense, in the sense of measures, to some rho, which belongs to h minus 1, and which is a global vortex sheet solution of the 2D Euler equation. And I will explain next what a vortex sheet solution means. H minus 1 means that your density rho cannot be a Dirac mass on a point, because it doesn't belong to H minus 1. But it can be, for example, a Dirac mass concentrated on a curve. Okay, a Dirac mass on a curve in 2D belongs to H minus 1. This is what the reason why we speak about vortex sheet solution. So the precise definition of a vortex sheet solution to Euler is the following one. So in fact, when you come back to the definition of the Euler equation, you remember this u gradient omega term. So you need to give sense to this product when rho or omega is only a measure belonging to h minus 1. And when u is defined by the convolution x perp over x squared with rho. So you need to define this product in the sense of distributions, and it was observed by Delors and Jauret and many other authors in the 90s that there is a trick. So if you assume that u and rho are smooth enough, you take a test function, phi, and you compute the divergence of u rho with phi in the sense of distributions. So you put the divergence on a phi, like usual, and you write this with the integral, and you symmetrize with respect to x and y the kernel. Okay. And you can use this to write as a double integral involving a function h phi, which is defined explicitly by this formula. H phi is 1/2 of the kernel x minus y divided by x minus y squared times gradient phi of x minus gradient phi of y. And the interest of doing this is that by the mean value theorem, this term is bounded by a constant depending on phi times x minus y, and this way you can get rid of the singularity 1 over x. So it's a very simple trick, which allows to give sense to this product even when rho is only a measure bounded in h minus 1. Okay. This is the definition we take. So I introduce this h phi of rho to be the double integral of h phi of d rho x, d rho y. And we say that rho is a vortex sheet solution if it satisfies the definition of the Euler equation with this product here. So we, instead of putting u gradient rho with the function, test function phi, we consider this h phi of rho, which is well defined for rho belonging to h minus y, as I said before. And Delors proved global existence of such solutions, such vortex sheet solutions. Okay. So I would like to give some references concerning the different various asymptotic regimes that have been studied for the Vlasov-Poisson equation, and in particular that of the work of Golz and Saint-Raymond, and Laure Saint-Raymond in 2002, who proved convergence to the 2D Euler under an assumption, a weaker assumption on the, a stronger, sorry, assumption on the L infinity norm of F epsilon zero with other methods. So it's a more Eulerian approach. And other authors studies other regimes leading to other equations than the 2D Euler equation, okay? Depending on the regime which is considered. So now, I would like to give also a sketch of the proofs. So we will start with a uniform estimate, because we want to pass to the limit in the equation for F epsilon. So we need some global estimates and compactness arguments. And if we consider a solution of the Vlasov-Poisson equation, we know that all these quantities are conserved, and therefore we get, as I said before, global bounds uniformly with respect to epsilon for all time. And it turns out that a uniform bound on the energy and on the momentum leads to a uniform bound for the h minus 1 norm of rho epsilon. It can be proved because essentially the energy corresponds to the L2 norm of the electric field, which is the gradient of Laplacian minus 1 of rho, and therefore you get an h minus 1 bound for rho epsilon. And this is why in the limit you get something which belongs to h minus 1, in fact. And more precisely, we have quantitative estimates, which means that we can estimate all these norms, L2 norm of rho epsilon, H1 log norm of the electric field, etc., explicitly with respect to, in terms of the L infinity norm of F epsilon, and therefore of F epsilon 0. So here you get an exponent which is 1/2, here 1/2, and it's a 1/2 plus 1 over Q, sorry, for all Q, okay? And this is due to the fact that we deal with a two-dimensional case, and all of this is very standard and can be proved very, very quickly. In fact, there are standard estimates for Vlasov-Poisson. But we really need the fact that they are quantitative. Okay, so now I introduce new Lagrangian coordinates for Vlasov-Poisson in order to pass to the limit. So it's a well-known fact on the linear equations that you can rewrite your solution, F epsilon of the Vlasov-Poisson or omega for Euler, in terms of the characteristics. Okay, the solution is preserved by along the characteristics. So here the characteristics are actually B characteristics, okay, X and V. X dot is equal to V over epsilon, V dot equals to V perp over epsilon squared plus E over epsilon, which means that when epsilon goes to zero, everything blows up. There is no hope to obtain a uniform estimate for V epsilon dot, okay? And I also introduce the characteristics for Euler, X dot equals to U. And I recall the definition of U and E epsilon. And the idea is to introduce a suitable combination of the characteristics in order to get rid of these divergent terms in the derivatives. So you introduce z equals to x plus epsilon v perp, so that formally z is more or less equal to x. Okay, so you are close to the dynamics of Euler. And on the other hand, when you compute the time derivative, you get rid of, there is a nice cancellation, and you get that d dot is equal to e perp of x epsilon. And what is e perp? E perp is x perp over x squared convolution with rho epsilon. So you get essentially Euler, okay? And a similar change of combination of coordinates was also introduced by Bostan, Ora, and Firo recently to study another asymptotic regime for Vlasov-Poisson. So I would like to mention this work. Okay, and thanks to this new use of Lagrangian coordinates, we can prove the following proposition, that if you take a test function and if you take a solution, you have this weak formulation for the solution. So you have exactly what we look for, and you have a small remaining term here, which is explicit in terms of the L infinity norm of F epsilon zero. So the consequence of this proposition is that we can pass to the limit, because it is a well-known fact that if I have a subsequence converging weakly in h minus 1 and in the sense of measures to rho, then the nonlinear term h phi of rho rho converges to the nonlinear term of the limit, because we have this non-concentration effect, because we have a convergence in h minus 1. So if you come back to your proposition, you pass to the limit in everything, and you get that eventually rho is indeed a solution of Euler. So we only have to prove the proposition, actually. And here I give a few details on the proof. So I recall that F epsilon is preserved by the flow, which means this is a notation here. It's the push forward of the initial data by the flow X epsilon V epsilon. So that for a test function phi, depending only on X, this is the point, I can rewrite this F epsilon of T times phi as this here. So here I have the initial data. And I recall that, in fact, X epsilon is close to Z epsilon, up to a small remaining term. So I can rewrite this as this, and I introduce a small remaining term, R1 phi of X minus phi of Z. And here I can apply the mean value theorem to estimate this by essentially a constant times F epsilon. So on the other hand, I want to compute this. I want to compute the time derivative of this quantity. And I use the dynamics of the explicit ODE satisfied by Z epsilon. So I replace Z epsilon dot by E perp of X epsilon. Okay? And I do the same trick as before. First I use that F epsilon is the push forward of the initial density by the flow. And then I replace X plus epsilon V perp by X plus a small remaining term, which is written here. Okay, so everything, it's just a simple computation. And again, I can estimate the term here, R, by a quantity depending on the phi times the LQ norm of, here there is no integral actually, yes. Yes, there is, by the LQ norm of the field. And I recall that for this, I have quantitative estimates with respect to epsilon. So everything goes to zero. Okay. This was the first part. And in the 4 minutes that remain, I would like to present another result concerning the Vlasov-Poisson with a point charge. So I would like to do the same kind of study of analysis if I consider the interaction of a smooth density, as before, F, and a point charge, a heavy point charge with charge Q, positive, located at a point psi of t with velocity eta of t, which corresponds to putting this delta function in the total density. And my question is whether in the limit, in the gyrokinetic limit, I get, instead of the Euler equation, the usual Euler equation, I get the interaction of the Euler equation with the point vortex, which would be the analog object, in fact. So I write here the equations corresponding to this kind of interaction. So it's the same as before, except that I add this field, this singular field here, created by the point charge, and in the limit, I add the velocity created by the point vortex, and for the Vlasov-Poisson, the evolution of the point charge is given by a second order ODE. Okay? It evolves under the action of the field created by the electric particles. And for the Euler equation, the point vortex moves with a velocity induced by the regular part of the vorticity. So interaction in both situations. And I ask whether when epsilon goes to zero, I get this limit. Here I just recall a few results concerning the study of the first system, Vlasov-Poisson with point charge, and the vortex wave system, which was studied by Marchiori and Pulvirenti in particular. And there are several existence and uniqueness results. And in particular, for which we assume that the point charge or the point vortex does not belong to the support of the vorticity in order to avoid collisions and to avoid singularities. And here I do essentially the same assumptions on the initial data as before. So I assume that F epsilon zero satisfies uniform bounds for the energy. And this time the energy takes into account the energy created by the point charge, which is written in red. So essentially the same kinds of of assumptions and the theorem is that up to subsequence, the macroscopic density converges to some rho belonging to H minus 1. And the sequence of point charges converge locally uniformly to some psi. And here I write the equation for the limiting object, which is a little bit more complicated than before. So essentially, rho plus delta psi is a kind of solution to a nonlinear equation which resembles the Euler equation when q equals to 0 or to 1. Okay. So I have this nonlinear term here, which is a little bit strange because I have to put q here. And I also get a defect measure. A defect measure, which is this object nu here. And we don't know whether we can get rid of this object. So just a few remarks to conclude. If I take q equals to 0 in the previous equation, which corresponds to the case without charge, then we retrieve a solution to Euler. And if we take q equals to 1, then this reduces to the generalized formulation of the Euler for the total vorticity given by rho plus delta psi. And if we can prove that there is no defect measure and that moreover rho is sufficiently smooth, then we can decouple the equation for the total vorticity and we get a system coupling a PDE for the evolution of rho and an ODE for the evolution of psi, which is exactly the Euler equation for q equals to 0 and the vortex wave system for q equals to 1. So it's a different system which has not been studied before as far as I know, okay, when q is different from 0 or from 1. Okay. And I think I will stop here. Thank you very much for your attention. I don't know how to do so. At least we should assume that they have the same sign in order to avoid collisions between them. But then, from a technical point of view, to pass to the limit is, I think, complicated.
There will be some interaction between the two points?
Probably. And what we expect is that in the limit we get a vortex wave system with two point vortices, which was also studied independently from Vlasov-Poisson. But from a technical point of view, I don't know how I can pass to the limit because there are so many singularities. So I don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.